Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivaradhari. Yashodanandana Vraja Jana Ranjana Yashodanandana Vraja Jana Ranjana Yamuna Thira Vannacha Tamashloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki Krishna Yavasudevaya Devaki Nandanayacha Nanda Gopakumaraya Govindaya Namo Namaha. Hare Krishna. So we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 11, Chapter 20, Chapter entitled Pure Devotional Service, Text Number 13. Na naraswargatim kankshen Narakim vavichakshana Nemam lokam chakankshetha Deha Veshat Pramadyati Na Nara Swargatim Ka Nara किंवाभिचक्षणाः नेमं लोकं च कांक्षेत देहावेशत प्रमाद्यते न नरस्वर्गतिं कांक्षेयेन नारकिं वा विचक्षणाः नेमं लोकं च कांक्षेत देहावेशत प्रमाद्यते माताजी न नरस्वर्गतिं कांक्षेन नारकिं वा विचक्षणा हेमं लोकं च कांक्षेत देहावेशत प्रमाद्यते. वर्ड टू वर्ड ट्रांसलेशन. न नेवर नर अ ह्यूमन बीइंग स्वगतिम प्रमोशन टू हेवन कांक्षेत शुड डिजायर नारकिम टू हेल वा और विचक्षणा अ लर्नड पर्सन न नॉर इमम दिस लोकम अर्थ प्लैनेट च ऑल्सो कांक्षेत वन शुड डिजायर देह इन दिस मटीरियल बॉडी आवेश फ्रॉम अब्सॉर्प्शन प्रमाद्यति one becomes a fool. Translation and purport by disciples of His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada ki jai. Translation: a human being who is wise should never desire promotion to heavenly planets or residence in hell. Indeed, a human being should also never desire permanent residence on the earth. For by such absorption in the material body, one becomes foolishly negligent of one's actual self-interest. Purport: one who has achieved human life on the earth has an excellent opportunity to attain spiritual liberation through Krishna consciousness or devotional service to the Lord. Thus, one should not desire promotion to heaven or risk residence in hell, where excessive enjoyment or punishment deviate one's mind from self-realization. On the other hand, one should not think, the earth is so nice, I can stay here forever. One should develop thorough detachment from all the aspects and categories of material existence and go back home, back to Godhead, where life is eternal and full of bliss and knowledge. Lord Krishna now begins to develop his conclusive proof that actual human progress lies beyond material piety and sin. The Lord first clarified that there are basically three methods of human elevation, namely jnana, karma, and bhakti. And the goal is transcendental knowledge and ultimately love of God. Now the Lord explains that promotion to heavenly planets, the final goal of piety, as well as residence in hell, the result of sinful activities, are both useless in fulfilling the actual purpose of life. Neither material piety nor sin establish the eternal living entity in his constitutional position. Therefore, something more is required to achieve the actual perfection of life. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya चक्षुरोन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं वन्देहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजाथां सहगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च हे कृष्णा करुणा सिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकान्त राधाकान्त नमोस्तुते तप्तकाञ्चन गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे 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 कृष्णा So we would like to welcome you for today's morning Srimad Bhagavatam class. And in the beginning, I would like to pray for the blessings of all the devotees present here, that I may be able to speak something on this great exalted subject matter of Srimad Bhagavatam. So today is a very, very auspicious day. Today is the disappearance day of Srivas Thakur. And so we will be discussing both on this verse on Srimad Bhagavatam as well as we will discuss something about Srivas Thakur also. So in today's verse, the translation, it is said, a human being who is wise should never desire promotion to heavenly planets or residence in hell. Indeed, a human being should never desire permanent residence on the earth, for by such absorption in the material body, one becomes foolishly negligent of one's actual self-interest. So, in the last few verses, in this chapter, which is actually entitled Pure Devotional Service, Lord Krishna is explaining to Uddhava that what is, how the process of bhakti, which has been given, is the best process. Lord Krishna, in one of the previous verses, as is explained in today's purport also, he had given basically three main paths. The first one was the Jnana Marg, the Karma Marg, and the Bhakti Marg, or the devotional service. And he himself expressed that although Jnana Marg and Karma Marg are there, but ultimately they need to lead to bhakti. That is the perfection, to know who is the Supreme Personality of Godhead and how we can love or establish our relationship with Him, and the prayojan that is to engage in loving devotional service. And in this verse now, and in this entire chapter, Lord Krishna is going to establish how this process of bhakti is the topmost. In today's verse, he is saying that now that we have got this human form of life, then we should, and this is the most excellent opportunity to attain spiritual liberation through Krishna consciousness. It's a very, very rare opportunity that we have got. And it is an opportunity which is sought after by all, even the residents of the heavenly planets, the demigods, and all the other, the residents of the lower planets also. In Bhagavatam, we see there are many places where exalted devotees have expressed this desire. And this fact has been told many a times. Like King Rahuguna, in his prayers, he says, the birth as a human being is the best of all. Even birth among the demigods in the heavenly planets is not as glorious as birth of a human being on the earth. So what is the use of the exalted birth as a demigod, as a devata? Or because of too much of sense enjoyment and great facilities, it is very difficult for them to engage in pure devotional service of the Lord. So to have got this birth as a human being in this material world is actually a very, very great fortune for each one of us, which we may actually not realize. We see that an intelligent person is one who actually makes use of whatever opportunity he gets. Because opportunity does not come to everybody. But for one who has got an opportunity, if he does not make best use of that, then it is considered very, very unfortunate. So, if a person who has got a human birth and he does not make use of this to get the association of devotees and to cultivate devotional service, bhakti, then he is considered very unfortunate. Even that's why Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu always used to say that Brahmanda Brahmite Kono Bhagyavan Jeev Guru Krishna Prasade Paye Bhakti Lata Beej. It's actually a very, very great fortune. And if we see, there are many people who are living maybe in the various planetary systems. Just some time back, I was discussing with Pavaneshwar Prabhu that how there are different in one universe, there are so many lokas. We have the upper planetary system, the middle planetary, and the lower planetary systems. And there are unlimited living being entities who are there. But even in the heavenly planets, means once the pious credits are over, then they have to come back to this Martyaloka. Chine Punyam Martulokam Vishanti. So the demigods, although they are staying in heavenly planets and they are enjoying the comforts over there and all the facilities over there, but in the heart of heart, they are praying that, okay, let us get birth in the Bharat Varsha. Means after our Punya is over, then because they are forced to enjoy whatever the pious credits which they have earned in their previous lives, they are forced to enjoy over there. But they are praying that once our pious credits are over, then let us come and take down to the Bharat Varsha and take birth over there, because here there is this opportunity to engage in devotional service and take the association of the devotees. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also many a times has emphasized on this, that Bharat Bhumite Janma Hilajar Janma Sarthak Kari Karo Paro Upkar. So especially not only in the earthly planet, people who have taken birth in country like India, Bharat Varsha, Bharat Bhumite, so they are the most fortunate amongst the people who are living in the earth. So now that we have got this opportunity, we should not waste it in other types of activities, as is explained over here, that if we use this opportunity to promote ourselves to heavenly planets, or if we are engaging in sense gratification in this, thinking that, okay, means better to enjoy whatever we have right now, who knows about the future. If in that case, what happens? We are engaged in sinful activities, which actually leads us to hellish life in the future. So, If we see, means, as I was mentioning, we were discussing that in the upper planetary systems, if we see, means there are in all 14 planetary systems. And in one universe, we have the Bhuloka is considered the middle. Above that, we have the Bhuvar Loka, the Swarga Loka, then the Mahar Loka, Jana Loka, Tapa Loka, and on at the topmost is the Satya Loka. So if we see that the Swarga Loka, the residents are all the demigods. And they are the various administrators, and now as we see, there are so many prayers also of the demigods where they have expressed their desire that they want to come and take birth in India. In the Bhuvar Loka, the residents are the Gandharvas, the Kinnaras, the Kimpurushas, Vidyadharas, and along with them, they are the Yakshas, the Rakshasas, Bhutas, Pretas, and Pishachas. So all these types of living entities, they are all having a separate planetary system. That is the Bhuvar Loka. And in the Bhuloka, which is the middle planetary system, we have the Bharatavarsha, which is considered as the Karma Bhumi, where demigods, after their fulfillment, have to, anybody who wants to perform activities, they have to come to Bharatavarsha or the Karma Bhumi. And here also, there is Bharatavarsha and there is the other remaining portion, which is called the Bhuswarga. So, it is explained in Bhagavatam that the demigods who are living in the Swarga, they exhaust 90% of their punya over there in the Swarga, and then the balance 10%, of the balance 10%, 9% they enjoy in the Bhuswarga. And after that, with 1% balance, they come to the Bharatvarsha, or they pray for that, so that they can come here and take this opportunity to perform devotional service. And below the Bhuloka, or the lower planetary systems are there, which consists of the, which is also called the Bilaswarga. So if you see the upper planetary systems and the lower planetary system, the Bilaswarga also, the lower planetary systems, although they are below the Bhuloka, yet the opulences over there are also, if not better, at least same as the Swargloka. So they are called Bilaswarga, and these consist of Atala, Vitala, Sutala, Talatala, Rasatala, Mahatala, and Patala. And in all these lokas, means we have the Asuras, Daityas, and Danavas who are residing in these places. And below this planetary system, all these planetary systems is the Naraka Loka, which is again described over here, that when living entities perform punya, then they promote themselves to the higher planetary systems, and if they commit sins, papa, then they are made to go to the Naraka Loka, which is like an intermediate planet, where they have to suffer for their sinful activities, whatever they have committed. And they are also, it is like a preparatory place where you are prepared, your consciousness and your bodily features are prepared in such a way that you can go to your next destination as per your karma and your desire. Like Krishna says at the Antakalicha Mameva, means he says, whatever at the time of death, whatever consciousness you have or desires you have, and based on your activities, you get that type of a body in the next life. So we see that in this entire planetary system, there are so many lokas, and a living entity may be transmigrating in so many different places. There are so many unlimited opportunity places for engagement, but it is only in this Bhuloka or in the earthly planet that we get an opportunity whereby we can actually take to the path of spirituality. And rather than in this temporary material world, we can get a permanent solution for our life's various problems and achieve, as is being explained in this, that we can get the permanent happiness or permanent Sachidananda Vigraha that we can obtain. So, we see that even Brahmaji, he is condemning that a person who has got birth in this human form of life And if he does not utilize this to develop love for God, engage in devotional service, then such person is considered a very, very unfortunate person. And it is said, he says that, Srila Prabhupada explains in the purport, it is not possible to go back to Godhead in one life, but in the human form, one should at least understand the goal of life and begin Krishna consciousness. It is said that the human form is a great boon because it is the most suitable boat for crossing over this material ocean of nescience. The spiritual master is considered to be the most able captain in the boat, and the information from the scriptures are the favorable wind. So, if we fail to utilize this great opportunity, then it is, in scriptures, it is said that it is like committing suicide. You know? Means it is like the most unfortunate thing. So, we see that although this earth is also called Dukkhalayam Ashashvatam, it is a place of misery, and also it is impermanent, Ashashvatam. But we as a living entity, we are having a similar desire like the Supreme Lord, means of such, we are Satchidananda. We are eternal, we are knowledgeable, and we are always seeking for eternal bliss. But in this earthly planet, it is not possible because this is Dukkhalayam and Ashashvatam. And in another place it is mentioned that it is, this earthly planet is described as Anatyam Asukham Lokam. So it is temporary and it is miserable. So how is it possible that we can seek permanent happiness over here? So on the other hand, the devotional service, that is described as susukham kartum avyayam. It is susukham, always pleasurable, and it is avyayam, it is unending, or it is eternal. So, we can very well understand that it is a very, very great fortune which we are having. On the other hand, if people getting an opportunity in the material world use it for immediate sense gratification, even if it is whether based on the Vedic scriptures and performing pious activities and elevating oneself, or by not following Vedic scriptures, one performs as per his own whims and fancies and he commits sinful activities, he will degrade himself to the hellish conditions. And in Bhagavatam 5th canto, it's described how various hells are there for each and every different types of sinful activities. If one just, I was just, instead of going through the entire chapter, I was going through just the introduction. And even that introduction itself, or to that chapter, is giving us so much of description of different types of hells. It's really very fearful for us. So, better that we utilize this great opportunity which we have got. And as is also explained in this verse, that if somebody thinks that, okay, going up is also of no use, going to hellish condition is also again miserable, so let me stay over here. That also is condemned over here. You know? Lord is saying that one should not desire all that, let me have permanent residence over in this earthly planet. Like yesterday, Pradyumna Mishra Prabhu was describing that if somebody thinks that, okay, let me stay on the bridge. No, the bridge, the purpose of the bridge is to cross over. It's not that we make our residence on the bridge. Like if anybody wishes from Grand Road, say, to go to Thane. So, the human form of life is like a junction. If you wish, means people in Bombay, they are used to traveling by train. So, we know that if you want to go to the Thane, then you'll have to go up till Dadar, then change over. Hai na? You have to use the bridge to cross over from Western Line to Central Line, and then from there you can take another train. Of course, now they also have that facility from Prabhadevi. From Prabhadevi also there are certain trains which lead. So, similarly, our human form of life is also a junction where we can change our course of activities. Rather than just going up to the heavenly planets and coming down into the hellish planets, or
we can actually use this human life, which is like a bridge, to change our course and we can take to spirituality. In fact, even in this human life, if we see, just see the fortune which we as individuals have. In this Bhuloka, means it is also described that there are 84 lakh species of life. And amongst these 84, there are only 4 lakhs are human beings. The rest 80 lakh species are of other living entities, plants, animals and others. And even in this human form of human beings, we see that if you see around, there are so many people. And in the population of India is very, very less as compared to the entire world's population. And it is, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Bharat Bhumi Te Janma Hilajar, Janma Sarthak Kari, Karo Paropkar. And even in India, if you see, there are crores and crores of people. But very few people have actually the opportunity or the inclination to take up to devotional service. And we are so fortunate if we consider the entire scenario. We have taken birth just 500 years after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has appeared, and we have got an opportunity to be a part of this great ISKCON society, which was established by Srila Prabhupada just 100 years or so, even less than that back. So, and if we see around in this world, there are so many other people, although they are our contemporary, yet they have no inclination towards spirituality. They are all engaged in maybe either gross materialistic activities just for sense gratification, or they may be engaged in other so-called principles of following principles of religion, which may actually be promoting hatred and fanaticism in the society, killing each other. So if we just imagine or rather consider this entire proposition, that in this earth there are so many people, or even say, for example, in Bombay, the population of Bombay is so huge, but very few people are there. Not that only devotees in ISKCON are the chosen ones, but even those who are following the devotional service, even in other sampradayas also, if we consider all of them also as fortunate, but if we see what is the percentage of these people, and so many other people, they have got so close to coming to a solution for their life, but they are yet so far. So if we try to think about this, then we can understand that one is that how much fortunate we are, but that should not make us proud or make us arrogant. And rather, we should also contemplate that how much the other people are unfortunate, and we should try to share this process of bhakti or this Krishna consciousness with them. And that is what is the hallmark of a devotee, pure devotee, that he is always thinking that, okay, there are so many of my brothers and sisters all over, means all the atmas, we are all children of the same father. So why, and they are suffering. So let me try to get them to some solution. So that is the main guna or tattva of a devotee, hallmark of a devotee, is that he is the most compassionate upon all living entities. In fact, it is said that he is more compassionate than even the Lord himself. And he wants to share this process of love and bhakti with each and every one of them. And there is this very nice example of how Ramanujacharya, when he got the opportunity of that mantra which he received from his spiritual master, although his spiritual master had warned him that don't share this with anyone, this is a very, very potent mantra and anybody who chants will get liberated. So Ramanujacharya, out of his compassion, not that he wanted to go against the wishes of his spiritual master, but only out of compassion for the living entities, he immediately he went to the nearest nearby temple and invited each and every one of the people living over there to come and chant this holy name and perfect their lives. So that is the compassion which a devotee should have, and we should all develop that quality. And we see that today is the disappearance day of Srivas Thakur, and Srivas Thakur also is in fact Krishna also in before his when he the disappearance pastime which he performed, means before that it is explained in Bhagavatam that although Krishna was the possessor of infinite powers and is the only cause of creation, maintenance and destruction, yet he did not desire to keep his body in this world. After completing his pastimes, Lord Krishna did not, although if he had wanted, he could have stayed internally in this material world. But he also decided, no, this earth is not a place to stay. We have to go back to spiritual world. So he also closed his pastime and he went back. So, because he did not want to give undue importance to this material world. So, and we also see that many devotees also, like Vritrasura and all, they pray that, like Haridas Thakur Prabhu was quoting this verse of, from the prayers of Vritrasura. Na naka prishtham, na cha parameshtyam, na shrava bhomam, na rasadi patyam, na yoga siddhir apunar bhavam va, samanjasa tva virahaya kankshe. That I do not desire to enjoy in Dhruvaloka or the heavenly planets or the planet of Brahma, nor do I want to be the supreme ruler of the earthly planets or nor the lower planets. What do I desire? I desire only that I want to be, I don't want even liberation from all this. I only desire the shelter of your lotus feet. And that should be the desire of each and every one of us. And we see from the life of Srivas Thakur that the situation in Navadvip was also very much similar to this, that all the people, they were all engaged in various karmakanda rituals of performing various karmakanda rituals and trying to either increase their sense gratification and enjoy material enjoyment in this world, or planning for future to go to ascend to heavenly planets and enjoy over there. And Srivas Thakur and other Advaita Acharya and other great devotees, when they saw all this, they were feeling so pity for all these people and how they were suffering, and then how they are not able to utilize this great opportunity of human life which we have got. And that was the reason that Srivas Thakur and Advaita Acharya, they all prayed that somehow, Lord, please descend and do something for bestow your mercy upon all these people. And in response to that only, Lord Gauranga Mahaprabhu, he advented in this material world. So, we have this Pancha Tattva, Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya, Prabhu Nityananda, Shri Advaita Gadadhar, Srivas Adi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Ki Jai. So, we have Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is Supreme Personality of Godhead Himself, and we have Nityananda Prabhu, who is the manifestation of the first expansion of the Supreme Lord. And similarly, Advaita Acharya also is an incarnation of Lord Vishnu, and of course Sadashiva also. And so these three, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nityananda Prabhu and Advaita Acharya, they are all Vishnu Tattva. And we have Srivas Thakur, who actually represents the devotee, or the marginal potency of the Lord. And Gadadharji, he represents the internal potency, Srimati Radharani. So, Srivas Thakur is actually a representative of all we living entities. And it is also mentioned in the scriptures that he is an expansion of Narada Muni himself. And we know from the full Bhagavatam that how much Narada Muni has been instrumental in giving bhakti and Krishna consciousness to so many living entities. And his stories are just very fantastic. So, Narada Muni had also played a great, very important role in the Krishna Leela pastimes, Lord Krishna's pastimes. And his friend, Parvat Muni, He came in, and Narad Muni has come in this Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Leela as Srivast Thakur, and his friend Parvat Muni has incarnated as his younger brother Ramai. And Srivast Thakur's wife, her name is Malini Devi, and she was she is an incarnation of one of the nurses of Krishna. Her name was Ambika. This is given from the God Ganesh Deepika. It explains that Ambika, who was one of the wet nurses of Lord Krishna, she came as Malini Devi, who was the wife of Srivast Thakur. And Srivast Thakur, Srivast Pandit, they all hailed from Sillet. And later on, they came to Navadeep, where they made an immense contribution to the in the Gaur Leela. It's explained in Chaitanya Bhagavat and Chaitanya Charitamrita that Srivast Thakur had three other brothers. He was the second. His eldest brother, his name was Sri Ram Pandit, and his elder brother's name was Nalina Pandit, and his daughter was Narayani Devi. We will come to that. So he had three other brothers: Sri Ram Pandit, Shripati Pandit, and Srikanta and Srinidhi. So all four were all participants in Mahaprabhu's Leela. So Srivast Thakur's father was a Brahmin, and his name was Jaladhar Pandit. And the eldest of the son was Nalina Pandit, and whose daughter was Narayani Devi, who is the mother of the author of Chaitanya Bhagavat, Vrindavan Das Thakur. So Narayani Devi had a very, very close relationship with, and Vrindavan Das Thakur had a close relationship with Srivast Pandit. Yeah. And these four brothers, they used to live in Srihatta, and when they came to Navadeep, they had very friendly relationship with Jagannath, they used to have very friendly relationship with Advaita Acharya, and they used to assemble at his home and hear Srimad Bhagavatam classes, and they used to chant Kirtan together. And gradually the brothers, they all became very close friend of Sri Jagannath Mishra also. And Malini Devi and Sachi Mata, they were also very, very good friends. So when Srivast Thakur and Advaita Acharya, they were praying to the Supreme Lord to come and descend in this material world, then when Sachi Mata gave birth to Nimai, then both Jagannath Mishra and Srivast Thakur, they approached Malini Devi to come and help Sachi Mata and take care of Nimai. And she used to actually take care. They were like parents of Nimai. In fact, means they had so much of love and care for Nimai that they would even chastise him sometimes, because as child Nimai, we all know that he became a very pandit, and he was like a little arrogant at that time. So their hearts were filled with parental affection and without any trace of any awe or reverence at that time. Because at that time, Nimai or Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he never disclosed himself as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He was just like displaying his pastimes as Nimai Pandit. So once, it is this pastime many of you may not have known, that once it so happened that Srivas and Malini gave Sachi Mata and Jagannath Prabhu advice on how to take care. Like we have parental training course. So they used to give training to Jagannath Mishra and Sachi Mata on how to take care of Gaur Sundar. So, and once when Srivas Pandit saw that Nimai is becoming very arrogant, so he decided that, okay, I need to give him some counseling. So he called Nimai and then he said that, why do people study? Is it that just to get become pandit or become proficient in Vedic scriptures? But if you do not develop love for Krishna, if you do not develop devotion for Krishna, then all your study, all your panditya is just waste of time. You know, it is just shrama evahi kevalam. So better you develop some devotional qualities and start practicing, doing worship for Lord Krishna. So when Nimai heard all this, then he started to laugh. And then he said that surely, by your mercy, someday I will also become a devotee of Krishna. And soon, very soon, then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to Gaya in the pretext of offering Shraddha for his father. And there he met with his spiritual master, Ishwarapuri. And then from there, he started this Sankirtan movement. And we all know that Shiva's Angan is considered as the Rasasthali, hai na, of the place where this Ras Leela of Sankirtan was conducted every day and night. You know. And there are many such pastimes of Lord Krishna, of this Ras Leela. And one day in the Mahaprakash Leela, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he entered into Shiva's house and he started roaring and he said that I am he, means I am the that Lord whom you are worshipping. And now you can offer me prayers and all that. And Srivas Thakur, when he saw, first he became very bewildered. And then after, when he realized that, oh, this Nimai Pandit is none other than the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then immediately he offered him obeisances and then he offered him so many prayers. And then offered him Aarti and so many other pastimes we have already heard from the lotus mouth of His Holiness Radhanath Swami Maharaj and many other devotees. So, a few of the pastimes we may try to recollect and remember on this very auspicious day is that one of the pastimes was when in one of these kirtan pastimes, there was one servant of Srivas Thakur. Her name was Dukhi Krishnadas, Dukhi. And she used to hide and see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and all the devotees chant kirtan and all. And she would also get devotionally surcharged and tears would flow from her eyes. And she would also participate in bringing water for the abhishek and all of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So one day, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that now, from today onwards, your name will be Sukhi. You know? And that's how he bestowed his mercy upon her. And one day, we know of that pastime when Narayani, as a very small young girl, she was there in this Kirtan, Sankirtan pastime. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, on seeing upon Narayani, he immediately called her and said that, Narayani, you chant the names of Lord Krishna and shed tears of love. And immediately Narayani started chanting the Lord's name and tears of love for the Lord was flowing from her eyes. And later on, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu blessed her and gave his Mahaprasad to her so many times. And she became the mother of Vrindavan Das Thakur, you know, by Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy. And then there is this pastime where once a very big mishap took place when Srivas Thakur's only son, he passed away. And that was just in the evening time. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had arrived with other devotees to perform kirtan that day. And Srivas Thakur became so, bewildered. He did not know what to do now. Because Lord himself has arrived to perform kirtan and this great mishap has taken place. So immediately he is... other family members, the mother and all, it's such a great loss to lose someone as your only son. And the mothers and all the other relatives were crying, but Srivas Thakur, he was totally focused on serving the Supreme Lord, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And so he requested his family members that, okay, although this mishap has taken place, it is only by the will of the Lord what has happened. And now the Lord is coming over here to perform kirtan, so please don't cry because we don't want to disturb his ecstasy in kirtan. And in case if you still want to cry, if you are feeling that this is a great loss, then you can cry later on. Don't disturb the Lord's Kirtan right now. And he said, and then he also warned them that in case if you are crying actually disturbs, then I would better go to the Ganges and drown myself. So such was the dedication of Srivas Thakur, that he was totally committed to serving Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And after the Kirtan, of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did feel that there was something wrong on that day, because he was not getting the feeling, same ecstatic symptoms. And so when he asked the devotees, then some other devotees, they said that, oh, actually Srivas's only son has passed away in the evening. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu felt so bad. He immediately said, Srivas, how could you do this? Why you, none of you informed us? So then Srivas Thakur said that, what is it that if one child passes away? Because you are Supreme Personality of Godhead, you are here and chanting Kirtan, that is the most auspicious thing. And in such a situation, if my son has passed, then surely he has got a good destination. And we did not want to disturb your ecstasy. So when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard this, he felt so grateful for the devotion of Srivas Thakur. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself came to where the boy was sleeping, and then he woke him up. And he made him talk that, why you have left the association of such great devotees like Srivas Thakur and his family? So then the child explained that it is all because of the wish of the Supreme Lord. You yourself, I have spent my destined time over here in this family, and now I have to move on further. And when the family members heard all this from the mouth of the child, they also became blissful, and they also could understand that this birth and death is only a temporary phase which happens in our lives. And the main thing is that we need to surrender to the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. And then after the boy again lied down and passed away, then all the family members, including Srivas Thakur, and they all fell at the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and cried tears of ecstasy. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself, he said that, don't worry Srivas, you have lost one son, but from today, both myself and Nityananda Prabhu, we both are you're like your sons. And we will, you can take us. Of course, from before itself, Srivas Thakur and Malini Devi had considered Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as their own son and brought them up. So, and after this pastime, we can see how Srivas Thakur has responded to the loss of his son. On the other hand, in Bhagavatam, if we see, when Gandhari lost her sons, then she actually cursed Lord Krishna. When all her sons were killed in the war of Kurukshetra, she cursed Krishna that you and your entire Yadu dynasty, they will also get vanquished. That was her response. On the other hand, when Kritaduti and Chitraketu Maharaj, when Kritaduti lost her son, only son, she complained or she said that this creator, he is actually an inexperienced person. She complained like that, saying that how can the child die in front of the parents? And we see on the other hand, but when devotees are there, like when Draupadi, she lost her 5 children. Out of compassion means, and when Ashwatthama, who was the killer of her children, it's not that they died fighting in a war like a Kshatriya, but they were killed when they were sleeping. So she went through so much of trauma. But when Ashwatthama, the culprit, was brought in front of her, out of devotional compassion on Kripi, who was the mother of Ashwatthama, she said that, I know what is the loss of a child, so I don't want to give that same pain to my Guru Mata. So that is the Vaishnav compassion. And here we see that how Srivas Thakur, for serving the Lord, although his son had died, but he kept it aside and he was fully surrendered. So we see there are other pastimes. We have already crossed the time. Means there is this pastime where Srivas Thakur, when Lord approached Srivas Thakur and said that, oh, you are always chanting Kirtan and participating in all the various devotional services along with me. How do you maintain your family? So then Shivas Thakur did not say anything. He just clapped his hand 3 times. And then that same pastime, that Lord said that because of your faith in the Supreme Lord, that even if Lakshmi Devi has to go out for begging, if such means mishap happens, but even then you will never, your house or your family will never have any shortage or any, all your opulences will always be there. And in fact, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had so much love and care for Srivast Thakur and his entire family. He said that not only Srivast Thakur and his family, anybody who is leastly connected also to Srivast Thakur, he will get my mercy. And that's how we saw, like how Dukhi and others, they all received Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy. So today on this very auspicious day, we can pray to Srivast Thakurji that he can bestow mercy upon us, and we can take this great opportunity of human birth which we have got and help others also just like him, and progress to back to Godhead and fulfill the goal of human life. Thank you all very much. Hare Krishna. We have already crossed time, so we can do this. Hare Krishna. Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Samavet Gaur Bhaktavrinda ki. Jai.